his holy word. Because we know one thing, what? He's never failed me yet. And I can't turn around. Amen.
Oh, we have. matter what comes my way, I will trust in the Lord until I die. I will stay on the battlefield. I will stay on the battlefield. I will stay on the battlefield until I die. I'm going to treat everybody right. I'm going to treat everybody right. I'm going to treat everybody right until I die. This morning's scripture comes from Psalm 150. Psalms 150. And it talks about praising God. He deserves our praise. And he's been better to us than we've been to ourselves. Psalm 150. It says, praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmness of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and his harp. Praise him with the timbrels and dance. Praise him with the string instruments and organ. Praise him with the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding symbol. Let everything that had breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. Amen. I enjoyed the service so far, and I'm looking forward to enjoying it a little bit more. Praise the Lord. Are you still on the battlefield? And I'm going to treat everybody right. Boy, I tell you, that's good stuff right there. That's good stuff right there. God bless you, choir. Our responsive reading will be coming from in your hymnals. It would be number 590. And of course, in our Bibles will be Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 18. When we all stand, we can read it together. And if you don't have your Bibles, like my brother said, you can look up on the screen. Christian commitment. This is a great following our lesson about faith. Faithfulness. Christian commitment. Paul writes, he says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto our God, which is your reasonable service. For I say, though the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. Our ministry, let us wait on our ministry, or he that teacheth on teaching. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. Not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Distributing to the necessity of saints, given to hospitality. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that do weep. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. All.
Rejoice. every blessed moment, by having every color, as you said, God designed to use us, and he want to use us for what we have. Some of us are waiting to get more. And we need to understand that God said you have enough, at least to get started. Right? So don't cut yourself short. God has not cut you short. He has given his son to die for you and have trusted it and trusted his Holy Spirit inside of you. So he must think highly of you. He thinks highly of us. So don't cut yourself short. You are fearful and wonderfully made. You are special. Amen? Great. I want to ask that we not lose sight of the need to visit the sick, share with those who are incarcerated, but those who are having trying time, experiencing trying time. That's what the Christian life is all about. But I want you to know I don't just preach from the pulpit. I visit sick and shut in. I'm not saying that we all can do it to the same extent, but we can do more than what we do. It's easier to preach from the pulpit. A lot of preachers don't preach from the pulpit, and that's it. What I'm looking for, what I'm encouraging, is that we visit. People are hurting. They care. And they want to know that you care. They don't want to know that their church care. I'm not coming through to you. Now listen, if we cloud on the outside, we're going to have to be cloudy on the inside. We hope the goodness of the Lord. You might have it tonight. We have Sister Ethel Young. If you don't know who's here, you can stop by the office. Our secretary will give you this. Those who are non-imperial sickness or whatever. And that those who are having a hard time dealing the loss of loved one, deal with incarceration of loved one, dealing with financial difficulty. That's so many problems that we face in this day and time. So you really want to help somebody. This is what God looks for. This is what he wants. You hear what I'm saying? The word that comes so selfish and so individualistic and so personal that we forget that Christ established the church that is going to be a source of support for one another. Am I helping somebody? Again, it's climbing on the outside. It's not happening. It's climbing on the inside. Amen. That's Sister Ethel Young, Sister Florence Turner, Sister Rose Gardner, Brother Jerry Wilson, Mark Coleman. We thank God for Willis Du Bois. He had surgery about 3 or 4 days ago in Venetia today. Some folks that have surgery, they out for about 3 years. The folks that look for a reason, they look for a reason to not come to church. And what I notice also, and especially here, I don't know about the grace of God, especially here, they have a loved one that passed, we got a funeral here, you can rest assured they're not coming Sunday. And for a while, I used to get all the, I used to get a little, I said confused. But I wondered who had buried in the day before. Yeah, but if they have a loved one that passed, I don't care if it be the 19th cousin. Yeah, if they have a loved one that passed, they will not come to church the next time. I love you because I told you to tell you. So we all stand for you. But all of things we need to look into. And as I said, the thought police will how we respond to his goodness in our life. Our theme for the year is what? Our Old Testament supporter scripture is? It said,
trust the Lord with all thy heart, and lean not to thy own understanding. All thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths.
Testament support the scripture is?
Yes.
It says, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we should rejoice and be glad. So glad, until at this time, we want to warn it.
Go forward.
Now, I did a series of lessons on how to know, how to be sure you are a Christian. And, I propose three tests that we can do to assure ourselves, not others, but to satisfy our own desire to know and to be sure. The first test has to do with the Lordship test. Have you submitted to the Lordship of Christ? Not just in the church, but have you submitted to the Lordship? Are you doing what he said do? Are you seeking to learn from what he said? And so you can't do that which you don't know. And then completed that, the next test was the likeness test. The likeness test. Are we seeking with all of our heart? Are we truly committed to being like Jesus? Are we asking God on a daily basis to give us grace to live the way Jesus lived? And our living the way Jesus lives, and will never arise to the level of absoluteness, where we're absolutely like him. But we can rise to the level of relative, relation, relative, related to him. So as we are related to him, obey him, yield to him, keep his commandments, pray, study, and work seriously, then our likeness will be related to who he is. When he is absolutely, we can be in such a way to my time relative. And to make it, excuse me, the central, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And then he turns around and says, you are the light of the world. Well, wait a minute. You are the light of the world. You say, I'm the light of the world. But are you saying that your life is related to this? He is absolute light. He owes his light to no one. But he is light. We owe our life to him. So we are related to him. And as we draw nearer to him, the more we become like him, the more we give ourselves to him, the more we look like him. Who resembles him. That's why he said, you are the light of the world. You're like the city that sits on the hill. Okay, so the last one was the love test. Now let's look at these scriptures. 1 John 2, chapter 7, verse. Look what Paul says. John, brethren, I write no new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you have heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and you. Because the darkness is past, and the true light now shineth. The darkness of the old age, the age of law, the age of animal sacrifice. The new age has come in. The new age began with Jesus Christ. And so that he is the new age, which is the age of grace, the age of light. The old age was the age of darkness. When he came, he instituted light. He that said he is in the light, watch this, and hate his brother, is in darkness, even until now. He that said that he is in the light, and he hates his brother, John says that there's something wrong. He that loves his brother abides in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. Two words you want to remember. hate and stone him. But he that hated his brother is in darkness, and walking in darkness, and going not whether he good, because that darkness has blinded his eyes. For the sake of not going too far out in this area, I'm just going to read it some more part. When he says stone, that's a word that refers to a trap or a snare. It is a trap that leads to other sins, such as resentment, bitterness, gossip, malice, jealousy, etc. So he said, those who hate. And so he shows us it's possible for a Christian to hate another Christian. Otherwise, he wouldn't have this. He said, well, I don't hate any. Do you despise the one you despise? Do you despise? Listen, the word translated hate is miserable. To detest or despise someone. Listen, we cannot have Jesus in our heart and hate our brother or sister at the same time. A hated Christian is as much a contradiction as a loving devil. Christ is the head of the church, and you can't love the head and not love the head of the head, and you're not love of the members of the body. If someone comes to you and says, you know, oh, I love your head, but I can't stand your own. I can't stand your feelings. There's something wrong. And we are members of the body of Christ, and Christ is the head. So if we love the head, we love what the members of the body. Am I helping somebody? God bless y'all. God keep y'all. Let me come to y'all. And I wouldn't. We can't escape God's demand in our lives. We cannot escape. We can put black suits on, we can put three-piece suits, we can put a robe on, we can stand by the door, we can sit in the pew, and we can be more than equal again. But that won't change what God said. And beware of the excuses and the criticism that Satan will place on your heart. Because he knows what God intends to help. He intends to deliver. He wants to bless you. And you can only be blessed with the truth. Because God is truth. My heavenly Father, so I thank you for present, being present. I thank you for coming today. I thank the Lord for you. Why? Because your coming can open doors for God's blessing in your life. Your coming can secure your deliverance and your redemption. Your coming to the house of the Lord can be of a means of receiving an answer for your question and solution to your problem. House of the Lord, your coming serve as a spotlight shining upon you so that you can see not the other person, but see yourself. It's so important that we see ourselves. This love that John talked about, it's goodwill, benevolence. It's not an emotional thing. It is a determination of the will. I will to love, to do good. I will to look beyond the wrong that's done to me and think about God's requirement in my life to be like him, to love in spite of my help is tonight. Yes, yes. God bless you. Our Father, how blessed we are to know you. Be saved, be one of your children, to be a citizen of your eternal heavenly kingdom.
Thank you,
Father. In all of our ups and our downs, you have been with us, and you have bestowed your mercy and your grace on us. We well aware of the fact now that we didn't deserve it. We don't deserve it now. But because you are a God of love, and because your writer said that you are not slack concerning your promise, but you are long-suffering. You tolerate us when we don't tolerate others. You're long-suffering in our lives. And you keep on giving us chances and chances. Because you want us to come into a living relationship, a vital relationship, a reward and satisfied relationship with yourself. Help us to know, dear God, if we confess our sin, your faithful and your just will forgive us. Father, you have called us to work with you in the salvation of men. You have called us to participate in the upbuilding of your kingdom. But some of us, dear God, we are slow to move because we can't shake a loose the wrong. We can't shake a loose the guilt. We feel that we're insufficient, which we are in ourselves. But we fail to recognize and acknowledge that our sufficiency is of you. And that if only we say yes to you, you will empower our lives, encourage our heart to reflect upon the fact that every man, every woman you use, ever you, they were imperfect beings. You're not looking for sinlessness and perfection in our lives, but you're looking for willingness and faithfulness. We want to be you. Give us that desire. The Bible says that you are the one, dear God, who works up in us both the will and to do. So work the will in us to serve you, to love our fellow man, and to give you the best of ourselves. Thank you, Father. I thank you for these young people. I thank you for the opportunity to share with them. I thank you for the opportunity, Heavenly Father, to share more light on what you have already spoken to their heart. And so I pray, dear God, that you will touch them in a special way. Every need that is present here, every special situation that is represented, I pray, Heavenly Father, that you will speak to that person and let them know that you're with them. They're not alone. And it's not about what they've done and what they've done. It's not about all that. It's about saying, right now, dear God, take me and use me. What will you have me to do? Pray that we have clean heart, with your right spirit in me. Restore to me the joy of my salvation. Give me grace to move forward. In your name, thank you, Father. Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all today. And the Lord keep you. Thank you.
get your heart in order.
He's coming back. trusting on. For he's coming again. Let us stand as we prepare to continue our worship service by the giving of our tithes and our offering. For we know the Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. But we want to give cheer for this moment. Repeat after me. We give thee with thine own. Whatever the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone. And trust, O God, from thee. Let us pray. Father, we thank you today, dear God. We thank you for being such a loving God. Such a merciful God. Such a forgiving God. God, we thank you for this opportunity you've given us to give back to you. You told us to bring our tithes and our offerings into the storehouse.